and at his side stood a tiny second, 12-year-old Sergei Karjakin. They both came from the chess school in Kramatorsk in eastern Ukraine, the greatest talent factory of that time. A few months later, Sergei became the youngest grandmaster in history, and when he, after a few more months, beat elite grandmaster Alexei Shirov, he told the journalists that he expected to become world champion at 16. 10 years after that plan, at an age of 26, he finally has a chance to do that. How did it happen when the world's greatest chess talent became grandmaster as a 12-year-old? Why has it since then taken him so long time to reach the top? And how has Sergei, who is born and raised in Crimea, been affected by the war in Ukraine? I decided to find out.
Доброе утро всем еще раз. У нас на очереди рубрика «Ребенок недели». И ребенок недели у нас сегодня Карякин Сережа. Доброе утро, Сережа.
Доброе утро.
Доброе утро.
Сережа, скажи, пожалуйста, ты учишься в школе?
Да.
В каком классе?
В первом.
А в какой школе?
В гимназии.
В школе гимназии? А как давно ты занимаешься шахматами?
2,5 года.
А во сколько лет ты будешь мастером? Не говоря уже о гроссмейстере. Как ты думаешь? Вообще, ты хочешь стать чемпионом мира?
По шахмату.
Конечно.
Да, я пожму твою будущую чемпионскую руку, это будущий без фильма. Ты еще занимаешься
первым ребенком.
I am in Simferopol in Crimea, at the local chess club where everything started. Sergei learned to play chess when he was 5 years old, and his talent was evident right from the start. And when he turned 9, the family had to make a big decision.
It was quite hard for me to improve in Simferopol. It was hard because we didn't have any support, any sponsors, just nothing, and we were quite poor. I mean, we were just normal people, but we didn't earn very much, and it was quite hard to support my chess for my parents.
Ну, наверное, это было порядка, когда ему было лет 10. То есть он уже показывал такие результаты довольно серьезные, и нас пригласили в Краматорск, и нам нужно было решить. То есть либо мы здесь остаемся, у нас здесь был свой бизнес, либо мы остаемся в Симферополе, живем как жили, занимаемся своим бизнесом, или мы кардинально меняем свою жизнь. И тогда понятно, что мы меняем ее ради того, чтобы Сергей занимался шахматами на совсем другом уровне.
Не, ну, конечно, здесь надо было бросать работу, переезжать в Краматорск. Конечно, это было очень сложное решение. Это уже было поставлено на то, чтобы переехать, чтобы он уже стал чемпионом мира. Он был уже чемпионом Европы тогда. И просто переехать в Краматорск надо было для того, чтобы он мог реализовать свои возможности.
We are in Краматорск. The city Sergei and his family moved to in order for him to train chess full-time.
When I was invited, I was so much happy that, because I have heard about this chess school, and it was basically my dream to get there. And I said to my parents that I want to go, and okay, please let's go.
I meet with Alexander Alexikov. He was one of the trainers at the Kramatorsk Chess School at the start of the new millennia.
Ну, я должен сначала, наверное, сказать о самом подходе в этой школе. Понимаете, значит, эта школа изначально как бы освободила детей от занятий в общеобразовательной школе. То есть, и они все время посвящено было целенаправленно шахматной подготовке.
9 o'clock we started to work and then we had a break for the lunch, and then we worked more. I could have spent all my day in the chess club, but maybe Maybe at the end of the day we played some computer games, so I had some fun also.
И три года жизни, я могу сказать, что три года я там полностью отработал. Значит, я не видел ни света белого. И вот знаете, как заснул и проснулся. Три года прошло, понимаете? Потому что после занятия 8 часов Сережа-то уходит. А мне же на следующий, на 10 часов занятий надо набрать материала, понимаете?
When I was 9 years old, I could easily work like 9 hours. And it's quite much, even for the big person, I mean, to work 9 hours is quite big.
Это троглодит. Это я не знаю, как вы это слово переведете, он Свету попросите. То есть это человек, который дракон, который сжирает, ему все время надо давать жертву. То есть он все время, он все скушает. Он все, что ты ему не дашь, он все переварит, еще требует добавки, понимаете как? Вы поняли, да? Вы сможете это перевести, да? То есть, вот поэтому в этом была трудность этого всего периода моей жизни. Но, с другой стороны, я же говорю, я чувствовал себя счастливым человеком, потому что, ну, понимаете, ну, встретить гениального ребенка, то есть на своем пути ты поймешь, как тренер, что тебе просто очень крупно в этой жизни повезло, понимаете? И ты не можешь работать в холостую или на полоборота, понимаете? Вот.
At the time it was the best place I could have been. Just nothing could be better.
In Getxo, outside of Bilbao, lives Ruslan Ponomariov. He was the big star from the Kramatorsk chess school and a close friend and role model for Sergei. Ruslan won the FIDE World Championship in 2002. Even though the chess world was divided then, and many from the absolute elite did not participate, it was still a stellar achievement from an 18-year-old. Ruslan, who is 6 years older than Sergei, tells me how they became friends through chess.
It was also to see, like, okay, he's younger, but when you were, like, put in some kind of, maybe, chess position, like, he understood, like, very quickly, like, more or less what's going on, maybe. So that's why, like, maybe language of chess, like, well, like, people of different age, like, maybe they have different ears, but just like maybe unites. And yeah, later I remember when I played match with Ivanchuk in Moscow, he also was one of my seconds, and we called him like coach for tactics as well. But I don't know, it was it was nice that he always was positive in general. He breeds a good atmosphere in the team in general.
It was a very, 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 very good experience for me because I was just 12 and I could have seen how big grandmasters are playing. It was very interesting for me. It was also interesting for me to speak with Ponomariov, with Topalov. It was just great.
Yeah, and this is Sergei. Sergei was always like funny, like you could see, like he had big like ears. I did. Also, small kid. I didn't remember how old he was in this. Maybe also like 12, 11 years old.
It was also very memorable photo because we have Ruslan Ponomariov and ex. President of Ukraine is Yanukovych. Yanukovych? Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh my God,
Yes.
Okay.
It was just great because I was in the middle of attention of the world, but still I knew that I have to work a lot to get this level of Ruslan Ponomariov. And now I think I'm done with this.
So is that what you think there?
Yes.
In 2003, the head of the chess school, Mikhail Nikitich Ponomaryov, dies from a heart attack. He was the great organizer who managed to gather sponsors, trainers, and talents from all over Ukraine in Kramatorsk. And with his decease, the structure falls. Sergei and his parents decide to move back to Simferopol.
When we came back to Simferopol, I was 13 years old, and starting from 13 to 19 years old, I didn't have any support. Again, just completely nothing. And maybe at that age, I missed some opportunities, because if I would have moved to Russia a bit earlier, maybe it would be easier for me to develop faster than I did.
In 2009, the Russian Chess Federation offers Sergei to finance his training and connects him with merited coaches. Sergei changes from Ukrainian to Russian citizenship and moves to Moscow.
Ну, вообще мы русские люди. Мы именно вот не украинцы, а мы русские. И Сергей, в общем-то, у него эта мечта была стать чемпионом мира. И, в общем, когда он уже именно стал спортсменом таким на серьезном уровне, мы поняли, что у нас здесь Симферополь на тот период, у нас в Крыму не было ни одного гроссмейстера. Вообще ни одного. И ему не с кем было заниматься. Ему довольно сложно было как-то и выезжать, и финансовой помощи не было никакой. И было понятно, что это уже торможение его развития, именно как спортсмена развития. Ну вот, и мы приняли решение, что мы будем переезжать. Москва поддержала это, нам оказали определенную помощь, вот так и переехали.
Рима был в Иван, Олимпиад в Ханты-Мансийск, Сергей played for the Russian team. And when we played Russia against Ukraine, it was quite important match, and Сергей beat Павел Ильядов.
It's not very great to play against your best friends, but what to do is a chess, it's a sport, and if you have to do it in the single tournaments, why not to do the same in the team's tournament?
But okay, thanks to Zakhar Yefimenko, who beat another Russian player, Malakhov, we tied 2-2, but before we played better in Jennifer's. And then he came to celebrate with us that we won.
When you took gold?
Yeah,
okay.
We took gold.
I take the night train to Kiev. Unfortunately, I did not get an opportunity to meet Sergei's personal coach during the years in Kramatorsk, the Grandmaster Vladislav Borovikov. But he has responded to my emails. I imagine his voice as I'm reading his answer.
Dear Mr. Turpin, my English is not very good, so I'm sorry for possible errors. In February 2002, I got an offer from Kramatorsk Chess Club to work as a personal coach of Sergei Karyakin. Sergei loved chess very much and was very serious about chess. He was ready to work as much as I can. He worked with me at least 5 hours a day, 6 or sometimes 7 days in a week. We traveled a lot together. Sergei's decision to move to Russia was accepted in Ukraine as normal and logical. He had not good coaches and financial support in Ukraine, and in Russia he got very strong team of coaches and support from sponsors. We don't have any contacts now. I'm still his big fan in chess, but don't want to contact him because of his position about Crimea and war in Ukraine. I never worked as a chess coach before and have not trained anybody after Sergei. If you have any other questions, I'm ready to answer. With best regards, Vladislav Barvikov.
Three years has passed since the Euromaidan protests, which forced Yanukovych to leave his post, and 2 years since the Russian annexation of Crimea.
Something happened like when all political things like Russia annexed Crimea, then started this kind of conflict in Donetsk region. Suddenly he started to be like so pro-Putin supporter. So for us in Ukraine, it's a little bit, I don't know, not understandable, because you spent so much time in Ukraine, like we were like many years like friends, and suddenly like you are like become so pro-Russian.
Maybe if it's possible, I don't want to speak too much about this before the match.
Okay.
Can we just?
Yeah. If no one else, yeah. It's okay. It's yeah. Totally okay.
He is maybe in some moment maybe started more to think about his life in Russia, about some his professional career and chess. I know he became too much, I think, too pragmatic in this aspect. And if you make such a statement in some aspects, I think you also support this kind of war, this kind of aggression, which is, I think, not good. But okay, I mean, the life continues.
Красиво. Серега, когда Крым переходил в Россию, Серега написал в Твиттере, что если я не возвращаюсь на родину, то родина возвращается ко мне. Вот это вот, типа вот, что он выжил. Да ладно, пускай.
I asked Sergei's father why Sergei, who has represented Ukraine all his youth, feels so certain about his Russian identity.
Дедушки, бабушки русские, папа, мама русские, и он тоже русский. Какие? Тут нет никаких такого. Он просто русский.
Ну, я отношусь к этому положительно, потому что, в принципе, у него есть свое мнение, у него, в общем-то, определенная позиция. Я нормально к этому отношусь. Это нормально.
Is it a way to kind of give something back to the federation because they have supported him so much?
Нет, нет, это просто его жизненная позиция, конечно.
I travel back to Moscow for my last meeting with Sergei. We meet at the chess museum on Gogol Boulevard and take a walk together with his wife Galia. I asked Sergei about the TV interview he did as a small boy.
I think I was 6 or 7 years old, and I was first time in my life invited to TV, and it was fun.
Do you remember how was it?
Yes, I remember. I was shaking hand with a TV speaker, and I didn't want to leave his hand, and it was like this.
It is exactly 1 month before the World Championship match starts, and Sergei, who became a father 1 year ago, tells me how that has affected his life.
I think in a positive way, because, for example, when I played candidates tournament, I was visiting my family sometimes, because it was in Moscow, and it was inspiring me, and I'm very happy. Maybe it's even important than it's more important than the chess title.
Как вы будете праздновать Сережину победу?
Сейчас затруднительно сказать, но я, честно говоря, я очень верю, что он способен на это.
Нервничать будете?
Нервничать, безусловно. То есть я, потому что считаю, что, понимаете, это будет незавершенный мой жизненный цикл, мое предназначение. То есть если он, скажем, станет чемпионом мира, то есть мне будет легко умирать.
Так. Я, блядь, уже вышел.
Да. То есть то, ради чего я был запрограммирован, то есть я выполнил. Будем так считать.
Вот здесь родился и я, и Сергей. Вот шахматный клуб 100 метров.
I ask Sergei's father whether he ever ponders the decision to dedicate his life to his son's career.
Да я постоянно об этом задумывался, правильно ли я делаю или нет, и до сих пор задумываюсь, правильно делаю или нет. Ну, уже поздно, короче, что-то делать.
I will be world champion, if not now, I will be world champion later, but of course better now.
Ну, это... Я посвящаю свой ноктюрн, Арно Бабаджаняна, участникам матча на первенство мира. Желаю им красивой и успешной игры.